Welcome to Forster University's Teach Your Gravel Roads a Lesson webinar, sponsored by Gravel Roads Academy. Our presenter today is Ken Scorseth. I'll be introducing Ken in just a minute, but as we wait for everybody to come online, I'll cover a few housekeeping items. First, my name is Beth Tompkins. I'm the Director of Education and Training at Forster University. I'll be your moderator today behind the scenes, taking your questions for Ken throughout the broadcast so that he may address them during our Q&A session at the end. Today's webinar is scheduled for approximately 1 hour with a 15 to 20 minute Q&A session to follow. Those who stay to the end of today's webinar will receive 1 PDH and 0.1 CEU credits. Today's webinar is interactive, and we encourage you to ask questions throughout the webinar. You may do so by entering a question in the question box and clicking send. These will come to me during the webinar, and I'll pass them on to Ken to address during our Q&A session at the end. If we run out of time today, we will respond to any remaining questions via email. You may also adjust your audio here, as well as start and stop the presentation, expand the slides to full screen, read up on our speaker, read up on our sponsor, and download the slides, the group sign-in sheet, the additional attendees registration sheet, and the quiz for those of you who are watching the webcast version later. As a reminder, all attendees can receive 1 PDH and 0.1 CEUs if you stay the length and are registered. If you are listening in a group with attendees who have already registered, please download the group sign-in sheet available in the left of the interface, complete it, and send it to Amber at amacledowney@forster.net after the webinar. If you are listening in a group with attendees who have not already registered, please download and complete the registration sheet, which is also available on the left of the interface, and return it to Amber after the webinar. During this webinar, we'll be viewing live-action videos straight from the field. When the video displays, you'll be able to adjust the volume and expand the video to full screen using the video player controls. During this webinar, we'll also be conducting interactive polls to hear what you have to say. When the poll displays, select your answer and click Submit. These will come to me, and I will tally these up and share them with the audience. After you finish the poll or view the results, you can always click Return to Presentation. This will close the window so that you can see the slides again. There are a few best practices that we recommend for an enjoyable experience. First, we recommend jotting down this website and web ID so if we do lose you, you can get back in quickly. Second, we recommend using a high-speed internet connection with all other windows and programs closed to avoid any audio or visual lag. Third, we recommend turning off or setting aside all cell phones to avoid any buzzing or static with the audio. And finally, we are live tweeting this webinar. You can join us in the conversation on Twitter by following us at ForesterU and including hashtag GravelRoads in your tweets. We'll be following your comments and questions during the webinar as well as after. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speaker. Today's speaker is Ken Scorseth. If you want dirt on all things gravel roads, look no further than today's speaker. Scorseth has spent over 40 years studying unpaved roads throughout the United States and as far away as New Zealand. Scorseth's experience includes work in the highway and heavy construction industries, management of a county highway department, and for the last 22 years as a field service manager, program manager of the South Dakota Local Transportation Assistance Program at South Dakota State University. For over 20 years, Scorseth has been educating engineers, managers, elected officials, and maintenance workers on subjects such as gravel roads maintenance, low volume road maintenance, and management. Scorseth also served as the lead author of the Federal Highways Administration Gravel Roads Manual. In 2011, Scorseth's contributions to the industry earned him an introduction into the South Dakota Department of Transportation Hall of Honor for his lifetime contributions to local transportation in South Dakota and the nation. And with that, I'm going to put it on our agenda slide here, and Ken is going to take us through the rest of our presentation today.
Well, thank you, Beth, And good afternoon, everyone, or good morning, depending on where you are. I have friends clear down in New Zealand and Australia who could be connected. It's tomorrow for you, but wherever you are, welcome. We don't have a lot of time to cover a rather big topic today, so I'm going to get right into it. And the slide you see has 4 points there, which essentially covers the agenda today. First of all, number one, the word assess simply means we're going to talk about going out there ahead of time. Look at the road or street that you intend to treat, and that will be the emphasis today, by the way, a rather high-end approach this year to treating gravel road surfaces when traffic is high enough to justify it, and then I'll broaden that a little bit in a moment here. But again, assess what's out there. The geometry or the shape of the roadway, and that includes the ditches and drainage if it's a rural section. And then, of course, the material, the surface aggregate that's out there in place. Number two, prepare. This will be the preparation just prior to treatment, and what we're going to be covering today is treatment with liquid magnesium chloride. Number three, apply. Simply a quick look at application of the product and some tips about that. This is for everybody, not simply for vendors who would be applying. And then number four, a rolling or compaction and finishing, and some final general remarks just after that on some projects that I've been involved with that are excellent case studies, and we'll give you a big picture look at this as we near the end. Now, as we began, and I realize there may be a bit of a lag, but this really helps us as we start. Here's a quick poll. I'm going to read the question and then read the choices for clarity. Which of the following best represents your role? And I realize we have some groups participating in one location. Please then, would you select what best represents your group as a whole or the individual who has responsibility? So, are you a laborer? Or B, a motor grader operator? C, a working foreman out there on the road? D, a road supervisor having authority over an entire road system? And then E, all others, particularly if you are a designer or decision maker, perhaps an elected official. So, going over those again, if you are a laborer, click on that, please. A motor grader operator, critically important position in what we're going to talk about today. C, a working foreman, management role out on the road. D, road supervisor, could include a county engineer. And E, all others. With that, I will wait a moment. We'll see the results of the poll, and then I'll continue.
All right, great. Well, thanks, Ken. We're going to go ahead and give just one more second for you guys to go ahead and click on those answers, and we'll be sending the results over to you. You should be able to see that popping up there pretty quickly here. And it looks like, Ken, we've got 89% at other, designer, decision maker. We have 5.83% at road supervisor. We have 2.92% at motor grader operator, 1.88% at working foreman, and our last 0.21% answered laborer.
Okay. Thank you, Beth. So that tells me that broad category at the end is our largest percentage of attendees, and that's fine. I'll do broad coverage of this as best I can. We may have quite a number of designers and engineers out there today. I'm happy about that because in some cases this is rather new to that group, and I'll help you as best I can. Continuing, this first topic, assessment. And as I mentioned right at the start, this will be related primarily to two things. The material itself, the aggregate, the gravel, whatever term you use, the surface material on that roadway, and then quite briefly, a look at the geometry of that roadway, particular to Crown. I won't have time to do a lot more on that today. I want you to have some background to where the video clips were shot. You will see here, this is coming from a field training activity that was done just over a year ago on May 17. And also note that there are a couple of things, a couple of statements in case I forget to comment about them later, specific to the season. So again, keep in mind the actual training was just over 1 year ago. The location, interesting place. That was very good for us because we had a number of people out there, plus our video crew, and we were actually on a location where we could close the road that day. But it's very representative of what an actual road, public road would be. It's a soccer complex just out of St. Joe, Missouri, so you get the geographic location. The demonstration site condition is very interesting, and this is becoming very big across the country, particularly in the Central Great Plains and High Plains region, but again, all over in the U.S. I've had these questions from as far away as Maine, for example, and that is the fact it had an asphalt surface, and it had failed. It was a thin surface seal. I don't know how long that had been in place, but it had totally failed, and they could not afford to do rehabilitation and place a new asphalt surface. And so they were reverting this surface to an aggregate surface, and what the aggregate is or was is a native limestone that's common in that area and quite a suitable aggregate for treatment. And then finally, the traffic condition. This one actually had a very high volume of traffic throughout the entirety of the summer, early fall. And what's worse, it's challenging when you're building something in this manner where you will have a lot of turning movements, parking, backing out, and so forth, start stops, and yet this one did perform well. I'm going to launch the first video, and I'm really happy to do this. We're trying this for the first time this year. Instead of a lot of lecture and a lot of slides, we've got four actual video clips. I will launch the first video, and you can see the title. This is Assessment of the Road Surface Condition. And bear with me a moment. This sometimes takes just a moment to launch.
And I'm going to explain a little better out here in the field what we talked about yesterday with sieves. What we're going to do is verify that it meets the top size spec. And it does. And I would have guessed it does. So your supplier is very fair about controlling top size. What I will show you, we retain nothing on the 100% past the 1-inch sieve, so it meets that spec. Now I will talk about the number 4, which is that split between coarse and fine aggregate, which is critical, and it's the last sieve that you can use in the field. Once again, that number 4 sieve, which I talked about yesterday, what is retained on it is this, what passes it is this. Now, there's the split between coarse and fine aggregate. If you'd help me, we'll do one more just to see if we get much deviation. Now, what you are seeing is a comparison by volume, right? We're not equipped out here to weigh it, but you see a comparison by volume. If you remember the example spec that we used yesterday, we said as little as 50% can pass this sieve, or as much as 78% can pass this sieve. That's the band. If it's within that range, it meets the spec, at least between coarse and fine. I'm going to show you the number 200. Thank you. Now, I will quickly explain again, there's no way to do anything accurate out here with a 200. If this material weren't completely dried in a lab, there's no way you'd get any accurate test. But for now, I just want to show you what that is, that percentage passing a 200 sieve, which is the true fines. This is just split between coarse and fine aggregate, which is a different definition, but the true fines, remember, 200 wires per square inch, both directions. If you don't have some of that in surface gravel, you will never get a good dense surface, and consequently, it won't treat well with the chlorides, which we're going to do today. If the gravel has a natural characteristic of going into a bound and a tight state, then chloride takes over. It's hygroscopic. It pulls moisture from the air. It keeps it damp, which is essentially all it's doing, and the road stays in place. Now, here's what material looks like that passes the number 200 sieve. Yep. Now, what's in this pan will appear to you, and I'll pass this around. You can put your fingers in it. I wouldn't do this, but if you put some in your mouth, it's not even gritty. It's like talcum powder. That's what passes a 200. So I'll pass the sieve around, but I want to show you something. I can continue to shake this. Do you see what's going through it? It doesn't even fall to the ground. And we have just a slight breeze today. It just goes off into the atmosphere. In dry form, that's what passes the 200 sieve. And I'm not going to do it, but I could shake this till noon and we'd probably still be getting a little dust, right? It is so fine. You have to have some again to get a tightly bound surface that will treat well. Too much of it, though, is not good. You get too much of this, what will happen is if you get a drizzly 2 or 3 day rain, it will rut, it'll lose stability. Also, it can get rather slippery sometimes when it's wet. But you notice all the time I'm talking, we still keep getting dust. It's not a high percentage of the total mass, but is so extremely fine to get the last bit of dust out of here is about impossible. Okay, we're going to treat 24 feet of this, which will simulate a local road. And I've got that marked, the outer edge, which will be 12 feet off road center that way and 12 feet off road center here. So, I'll have this gentleman who volunteered set the level right here, which is road center. Just level it up with the bubble. That's nothing but a carpenter's level. We'll get it about perpendicular to the road. There you go. Yes. Now move that stick till it catches the laser light. Okay, for those of you who can't see it, where are we reading? Where is the laser light? It is four inches. So what is actual crown?
Three and
one half, because that light is 1/2 inch above the base of the level. So we know actual is 3 1/2 inches here. Now reverse it, because the two sides are seldom the same. You will have to flip the level. Stay in the same place. Now, this will work in sunlight. We simply have to cast a shadow on the stick. There you go. Cast a shadow on the stick and move it till you catch the light.
There it is.
Do you see what we have, everyone? We have absolutely no crown over here. We can't measure it. We're flat. Flat in our business is dangerous. What's going to be the risk now if we can't get crown in here before we treat? Potholes, because if you hold water, even with a chloride treatment, remember, it's not a binder. It simply takes over. It works with the natural material, and if we hold water, traffic will pound that out, and you have risk of a pothole. Now, because of the asphalt that's under here, we're going to have some limitations in what we can do to put some crown in here. Over here, when we determined we did have 3 1/2 inches of crown, compare this to a rural road. If we use 4% crown as our target, remember what that translates to on vertical measurement? 1/2 inch per foot, right? So what would 4% crown be on a 12-foot lane, or 12 feet on 1/2 of the road? He's right, 6 inches. We are down at only 3 1/2, which is close to pavement crown, but not enough to get water off of a gravel road, as we discussed in the classroom. So we will try to put a little crown back in here. I've talked to the motor grader operator, and we know what our challenges are today, but this is how you do an actual ground check of crown.
Okay, this is Ken once again. I'm coming back on live with you, and I want to make some comments following that video. I'm a little unsure of lag time for everyone, but I will go ahead. I now have a slide up for you. The heading simply says post-video commentary. And I would like to talk about those bullet points. Keep in mind, what I showed out there in the field was simply partial, primarily the split between the coarse and fine aggregate, which either is retained or passes a number 4 sieve. And that sub point there, I love to do this because everyone gets some basic concept of quality control simply starting with gradation. Now, there's more than that. I like to see liquid limit and plastic limit testing, or Atterberg limits, as some of you would refer to it, to see if the fines have any plasticity. But this is where we start. The second bullet, though, very important, that is basic field training. It's very valuable, but the true control of a surface aggregate really needs to come from laboratory testing, and that's what we're saying in that second bullet, and I really, really believe in this. Like to see full testing of aggregate before we ever place it on the road, because it has so much to do with whether a treated surface is going to perform well or not. And it leads to that final bullet, I'm saying you must test. Well then, testing for what? It leads to this point, and I'll show something in a moment. You need to establish a good surface aggregate specification, which is not necessarily, and quite often is not the same as a good base aggregate specification, or cushion gravel, or a lot of the other aggregates we would use in construction. Again, I'll give you a little better definition of the band on sieves here in a moment. I want to show you one other slide, though, just for general interest. This comes from a different training exercise I had done in a completely different place. But again, out on the road, this would not be accurate. I'll emphasize that again. You can't do anything below the number 4 sieve with any accuracy whatsoever out in the field. But it's just so interesting. When you look at the control of the top size, the coarse, the stone sizes, if you will, two of those, and then here would be the split, if you can see my cursor, between the second file from the top and the third. Everything below here passes that number 4. This is coarse aggregate at the top, fine aggregate down here, all the way down to this little pile at the bottom, which passes the number 200 sieve. You need a very nice blend of these sizes to have a real good performing surface gravel. So, I'm going to very broadly discuss this with an actual sample specification for surface aggregates. And left column is simply the sieve sizes that you would use to control this. Then the center column is the first specification. And then third column is a second specification, and I want you to note the difference. The center column has 100% passing a 1-inch sieve as top size control. If you go down to the bottom, I'm splitting these by average annual moisture, because that really affects how gravel performs and how a treatment will perform. The first spec here with a double asterisk, it works better for areas that have 20 inches average annual moisture or greater. When we get to drier regions, and that's the right-hand column, the far right column, I much prefer 100% passing control on a 3/4-inch sieve. Because in those regions, we don't get as much moisture to keep our gravel in place. It makes maintenance more difficult, so that's the first difference. I'll just point out three things. I've already pointed the first one here on top size control. The second one would be the percentage of true fines, which passes a 200 sieve. In regions with higher moisture, these roads will perform with less of that. That's a fairly broad band, as little as 3% passing. I actually think that's quite low, although several states have specs that are close to this. 12% for the high end of the band. But over here in the drier regions again, and by the way, average annual moisture, for those in northern regions, I am including snowfall in that. So now we're talking considerably drier regions. I like to see the band now changed from no less than 8% passing a 200 sieve, and the higher end moved up to 15%. I've actually worked with some gravels even higher than that, and in a very semi-arid or arid region, that will work as well. I do not like to see it higher than 18, however. And then quickly, for sake of time, the bottom, plasticity index, coming from your liquid limit, plastic limit, or your Atterberg limits testing, a minimum of 3, even where you have higher moisture, a high of 10 on the range here, but in the drier regions, I like to see a minimum of 8 if you can get it. That can become challenging in a lot of places. That means 9 times out of 10, we want more natural clay in that gravel, and a high of 15. I don't have time to go into any further explanation of that, but quickly, there are 2 sample specifications to help guide you in this business. Now, another poll which helps us following this discussion, and then I'll talk about geometry, but we would like to know, do you have a local road surface aggregate specification? And please note the choices. Perhaps I can clarify a little bit simply by reading them for you. Do you have a local road surface aggregate spec? First of all, no, we don't have one. And if that's true, then answer it that way and we'll deal with it. B, I'm aware of one, but we're not currently using it. C, I'm aware of one, and I believe we're using it. And D, we have one, and we enforce it, or in other words, we require it. And I'll reread and also point something out again about the question itself. Do you have a local road surface aggregate specification? What is wonderful is if your state actually has a surface aggregate spec. Too many states in the U.S. don't have one, and so the best they're going to have is a base aggregate spec or cushion gravel, but again, too often, that's really not what we want. And if your state doesn't have one, then you have to go out on your own and try to establish one. So again, do you have it? No, we don't. B, I'm aware of a spec, but we're not currently using it. C, yes, I'm aware of a spec, and I believe we're using it. Or D, we have one, and we use it, or we enforce it. We require it. And again, I will mute here and let Deb step in and give me answers.
All right, great, Ken. Let's see. We're going to just give everybody one more second here and go ahead and click on the answer on the screen which best represents your answer. And here are the results come. We're going to just send those over to you right now. And it looks like we have, in our audience today, we have at 36% answering A, we do not have one. We have at 31% answering, I'm aware of one, and I believe we are using it. We have 27% at D, we have one, and we enforce it. And our last 7%, if we round it up, would be B, I'm aware of one, but we are not currently using it.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate the honesty. 6%, more than one-third of the audience is saying no, we don't have one. That doesn't surprise me because I've had a lot of experience with this. I would encourage you to look very hard at establishing one. On the other hand, just over one-quarter of our audience today did answer D. We have one, and we use it. We require it. I'm glad to hear that. 9 times out of 10, this matter alone gives us just 100% greater chance of good performance on these treated roads. And again, I want to emphasize that, just getting a handle on the material itself. Now, roadway shape is important, and I don't want to minimize that. And I will continue here with quick discussion on that. Roadway shape. We had some trouble with the road in the training video, and I think that was clear enough. But I want to emphasize once more, if you didn't get it, a crown on the traveled way should be at or near 4%. And what that translates to is approximately 1/2 inch drop per foot on the lateral distance each way from road center. And that's why the comment, we were simulating a 24-foot road top, 12 feet each way, we should have had 6% crown in that road, and we were starting with something way less, and we had to do some fairly aggressive shaping there. More than that, no obstruction of drainage at the shoulder. That's so important. Too many gravel roads have a secondary ditch, in other words, a high shoulder at edge of the traveled way, and we can't get water off of the edge of the roadway, and then some areas are very constrained, and I understand that, but the third point, I really like to see good ditch drainage at the sides of the roadway, and I'll simply go ahead and show you a few field scenes that we've worked with. This is very poor cross-section. You can probably see it's a desert area. This is arid, very dry. And one of the gentlemen in the class that we had in this area said, well, don't worry about it. It doesn't rain here. Well, yes, it does. Not frequently, of course, in a desert, but it rains virtually everywhere, more or less. And I get nervous about a road like this. It's actually inverted. The lowest part of the right-of-way is essentially a center of the roadway. This is not good. Ideally, I wouldn't treat one of these without a very aggressive shape of the, actually, most of the cross-section in this case. Now, let me move ahead to a completely different location. And by the way, I don't want to embarrass anyone, and there's nothing embarrassing here, but I won't tell you exactly where these are. But I shot all of the slides. I know the background to every one of them. This is a local road over in the southeast U.S., down in the Gulf States region. Matter of fact, this road, line of sight, would be less than 75 miles off the Gulf of Mexico. They get average annual 55 inches of moisture. But look at the contrast. They do have quite a few constraints here. They have a very, comparatively in an ag region, quite a narrow right-of-way in which to work, and yet they've done the very best they can. They were maintaining a 22-foot road top. And again, just in these conditions, a very good cross-section. I'll go to the next slide and just show you a close-up of their ditch drainage. And the vegetation obscures this just a little bit, but there's no obstruction at all. The water can flow right off of the road surface, right across hinge point here at the shoulder line, right into the ditch. The ditch had just been cleaned. It was functioning very well. Now we have a much better chance of getting success up here on the road surface. And then just once more, please prepare. Look at that geometry. Take some measurements. We have electronics in a lot of the motor graders today, even in maintenance. That's been out there in construction for quite a few years, but now it's catching on in maintenance, and that's very helpful. Where electronic slope controls in the motor grader will actually cut a 4% crown for you. So again, enough on this, but analyze it carefully. Instead of simply calling for some chloride and beginning treatment without any real planning and preparation. I now want to go to the next slide, which is actually intro or leads to the launch of our next video. This one will have to do with some quick work at preparing the road before treatment.
Remember what I said about pre-wetting. Chloride loves water. It's already suspended in water, and I warned you, don't try to treat a dry road. If you try to treat a dry road, here's what will happen. Do you see that product? Do you see how it literally puddles and it will simply cling to itself? The surface tension is so great, it won't absorb. And this is where too many dust control treatments fail. When the vendor shows up at the time appointed, but the road really hasn't been prepped, and worse yet, if it's not in a damp condition. Now, right over here, we applied water this morning. Do you see what it does? It immediately spreads or flows, and it will begin to absorb. I can't predict exactly what this will do, and someone may walk in it and ruin our little test here, but if indeed that doesn't happen, We will probably find this on the surface in a half an hour, maybe even an hour. And that's the problem if you're trying to treat on a real road, in real conditions, and you can't close it to traffic. If someone drives through this, it simply throws it off, and you get no effective treatment at all. Look what it's doing here. First of all, again, it just immediately flows because it loves water. And it will chase water down, to use the slang term, and that's what enhances absorption. And that's why we pre-wet the area out here that we're actually going to treat. Okay, everyone, just a little bit about the motor grader before we actually put it to work. Just a little bit about safety, because that's so important. We do a lot of chloride treatment almost as a maintenance procedure, right? Not construction. So you're out there on a public road and sometimes you can't close it. We're on a closed loop today, so we have the luxury of just standing out here. But on the public road, be careful. Put your signs up. Road work ahead, which is the universal first warning for a work zone. You could use be prepared to stop. You could use a loose gravel sign. I like to see more than one because then the public truly has warning. And if you are flagging, of course, put up your flagger warning sign as well. Now the machine, the safety here, was the backup alarm working? Yes, you heard it. Does it have a amber top light for warning? Yes. A working top light. That's critically important in the work zone. Four-way flashers, most modern machines have them. They're not primary warning. That beacon on the cab roof is primary warning. Make sure it's there and it's working. But using the four-way flashers is good. Just anything to give all the warning that you can. Now, the type of machine, the horsepower and so forth is not critical to me. Just the fact that the machine is in good condition. And this one appears to be. It appears to be in very good shape. The machine is quite new. Circle is tight, so it's easy to finish and prepare a road. Now, the cutting edge. If you want to come up, these replaceable bit type cutting edges. The one we have here is good for preparing for chloride treatment. These come in somewhat different types, different configurations, and how these bits are mounted. But I like these because of what we discussed in the classroom yesterday. These bit type cutting edges have a shallow scarifying effect, and they will open the surface so that we can get absorption from the chloride. And again, that's very important. Otherwise, you're simply getting a surface treatment, which will work okay for dust control, particularly if it's simply short duration or temporary. But when I showed you the roads yesterday where we're getting season-long performance, it's when we prepare it, as we're going to do today, we get good absorption of chloride, up to 1.5 inches, even 2 inches is good. And then we get a thicker crust or wearing course on the road, and you get a lot better performance from the treatment. Having said that, one more thing. When the operator starts, we'll have him tilt this cutting edge just a little more. Not sure what brand this is, but they are all essentially the same. They like to see the mounting plate essentially vertical, which means the bits themselves strike the road at about a 30 degree angle, and that's when they're the most effective. And that's all I need to point out about the machine. We'll all step aside and we'll begin preparation.
Okay, everyone, I'm coming back on live with you. I think that video was pretty clear and doesn't require as much follow-up. I would like to give emphasis, however, to just a few things, just a few more tips here on roadway preparation. I hope you're now seeing the slides again. Just a little more emphasis. Take time. And again, if it's dry, apply water, because once more, that gravel has to be in a moist state for chloride treatments to work well. And then take the time to prepare. Get that crown. Get that shape. And it leads to the second point here. Be sure you've got the correct profile on your finished surface. When these treatments work well, it's actually very difficult to reshape them afterwards. As a matter of fact, third bullet here, after the treatment, don't do any work with a motor grader. Do all of that ahead of time. Don't attempt to do any reshaping after you've applied the treatment. However, when you look further down through the maintenance season, the fourth point, I sometimes have the question, can any maintenance be done later on? Well, yes, it can. If you develop some light potholing or some distress that you need to do some blade maintenance, a good time is after a rain, a pretty good soaking rain, or if you have to wet the surface with a water truck, and you can do some spot maintenance. It's actually rather forgiving in that regard. But again, up here, do all of the work with a motor grader when you're treating ahead of time, and you're going to save yourself a lot of trouble. That's all I have. Follow up to that particular clip, which I think was pretty clear without much explanation from me. I want to now go on to the very next clip here, which has to do with the actual application. Again, keep in mind this is a liquid magnesium chloride product, and this video shows rather quickly, but I think very clearly, what we like to see in the way of equipment and a little bit about the process. Again,
what I have here is a clear plastic bottle that we've filled with the chloride right out of the transport. There is a specification on the chloride in most states, and what that means, it will be the concentration of magnesium chloride in water. It is always suspended in water. The specification in most states will be 30% concentration required, plus or minus 1, and some states will widen that a little bit, 30% concentration, plus or minus 2. What I have in my other hand is a hydrometer. You need about 7 inches minimum liquid in a container to float the hydrometer. In a lab, of course, we would have a good glass beaker. Out here in the field, I simply have a clear bottle. It has enough liquid to float the hydrometer, and this is how we test concentration. There. The hydrometer floats, it settles down, and when you read it closely, this material's in spec. It is right between 1.29 and 1.30, 1.30 being the middle of the range of spec in most states. The reason behind this is, if you have a higher concentration than about 32%, you simply cannot transport the product and keep it suspended. The solids will begin to settle out, and then we have trouble with our pumps, nozzles, and so forth in the equipment. On the other hand, you don't want a diluted product, or you're simply buying more water and less chloride, and it's not going to have the effect we want out here on the road. So briefly, simply, here's how you can do a field test. And I actually recommend that people do this, and reputable suppliers actually want you to. It's a check of their product in the field. Anyone can do it, as I described, with a hydrometer. I'm going to explain a little bit about the equipment that we use to apply liquid mag chloride. First of all, the tanker. It may seem small to you, but keep in mind, liquid chloride, as we just applied, weighs just short of 12 pounds per gallon. Consequently, these tankers cannot haul 6,000, 7,000 gallons, which you might think of as the average tanker hauling petroleum or water. So hence the reason for appearing somewhat small. It's a legal load at 80,000, that's all they can haul, and now you understand. Specific to the equipment, I like good equipment for application. Once we have the road ready, I like to see a truck that's ready to go, and this is a good example. In this case, the delivery tanker and the applicator are one and the same. He simply stops, starts the pump engine. He can put these bars out to full width, and full width on this rig is 24 feet. I like to see, if possible, a single application on the entire road. There's two reasons for single application. While the road is in that damp condition, and I'll explain that in a minute when we go over to the road, but while that road is in that damp condition where it will accept the chloride, you want to get it on there. It's not so difficult today because it's cloudy. We don't have much wind, but on a bright, sunny, windy day, when that road's ready, you want to shoot. So the rig that can apply in one shot, clear up to 24 feet, is good to me. The second reason is the fewer times we drive on that surface that we prepared by loosening, it remains that way. The more times or the more passes we make with the water truck or with the applicator, the more we tend to pre-compact or seal that surface before we get the chloride in, and that defeats the purpose. I'll just ask him to demonstrate the bar. You see how he can actually control this from the cab, but he can literally swing this bar out. He's ready to apply about 1 minute after he gets on the job. Go ahead, Brian. And now I'll show you something else I like. This particular rig is set up with nozzles, a pressurized spray bar for a very even application. Most of our vendors are getting better in this business, but this is just an outstanding example. And I'll explain the application system on most of our rigs today. It's an adaptation of agricultural chemical application equipment. Most of them are so accurate they can get down to about a gallon per acre. And that's even greater accuracy than we need. We just put 1/4 gallon per square yard on this surface. Again, this is pressurized, it's computerized, it compensates for his ground speed, the flow going through the bar, and then he dials in the prescribed rate. Very accurate. And I would just ask Brian if he has any other comments to make about the rig.
The only thing that I guess to add on is a lot of people will ask us to do narrower widths for, you know, different road widths. We can plug individual tips to do 22 foot, 20 foot, 18 yes. foot, all the way down to 1 foot. And then all we have to do is calculate that into our Raven system. And
it compensates again.
Yes.
And gives an even application. That's true. We wouldn't always shoot 24 feet, obviously. Matter of fact, we sometimes shoot one lane roads, and this same rig could do that. Now, what I'd like to explain for everyone's sake, we put the 1/4 gallon of the chloride per square yard on this surface already. We had it damp, not shiny wet, but on the high end of damp, as I like to call it, that's when the chloride absorbs almost perfectly, and that's what we got today. That just worked very well. It has been about 20 minutes since the 1/4 gallon went on here, and if you look down the road, we've got one shiny area there in a wheel path. We'll wait just a little bit, but this is already getting close. Matter of fact, right here, this will take second treatment right now. As soon as you know you've got absorption of the first shot at 1/4 gallon, we apply the second. We're going to make a field call out here to see if it would take a full 2/4 gallon, and we already know it will. So we'll put the 2/4 gallon here as soon as I get out of the way and stop talking. Then we'll watch absorption of that shot. And then we make a call on whether we're going to use a roller or not, or how much to use the roller, okay?
I'm back on with you, everyone, as that clip finished. Just a little bit of emphasis on this one again. If you don't see it yet, you're going to see a slide coming up very shortly with just a close-up of that hydrometer. I've found this isn't used a great deal in some places where I go. And just once more, I really do recommend that. And I will reiterate, reputable suppliers welcome it. It's a good control test out there. Here's just a close-up of a hydrometer in a lab and how you read those numbers. It's quite simple. Even if you've never seen one, you should be capable of going out and testing. That's all of the follow-up I'm going to do for now on what you just saw on application. I think that was quite clear. But again, a poll. We'd like to know before we begin to wrap up here, are you the decision maker for gravel roads maintenance? Now, that may not be necessarily everything we just talked about here, but later on, the maintenance of the road thereafter. The question is simple enough, yes or no. And to compensate for the time lag here, I'll go on and make some other comments. But once again, are you the decision maker for gravel roads maintenance? How it's done, frequency of it, and so forth. And it could include, of course, what we're talking about here as well, the high end of the business in which we're treating and stabilizing. So again, are you, yes or no? And to give you a little more time, I don't want to divert your attention, but I can tell you the rate we were using there isn't a one-size-fits-all. I've actually treated a 3-inch layer just a year ago on a project here in South Dakota. Had a very high-quality gravel. We used 3/4 of a gallon of chloride in a 3-inch. That would be a compacted lift of gravel. That became our wearing course, if you will. We had to apply that in 3 different shots. That project performed very, very well. It's a commercial access road. In a better world, it would be paved, but they cannot afford to pave it. So that's just one example. I can also think of another where we used a very lean application. And I wasn't on that road. A gentleman named Mr. Steve Monlux and I were involved with an advisory team, I'll put it that way, looking at some work out in Michigan. And I remember they told us they were using, when we calculated it, as little as 2/10 of a gallon per square yard, and were getting performance they were very happy with. But again, they had very good gravel, and then they're in an area that gets a lot more moisture. So just a little broadening of that principle on application rate, lest you take that as a one-size-fits-all rate. And again, that is per square yard. Now, the poll. Beth, would you step in, please?
Well, certainly. Let's see. We've got the poll results are just coming up right now for everybody. And we have 79% of our audience answered no to the poll. And the other 21% answered yes.
Okay. Thank you. That does help me. So we have a lot of people not directly involved in the decision-making, so I'll just, as I wrap up, concentrate more on how you can give those folks advice. With that, one more slide, introduction to the last video clip, which is simply covering rolling and finishing. I want to simply launch the video right now, let you watch this, and then I will come back on and wrap.
Okay, I'm going to explain 3 things here as we wrap up. First of all, rolling. We now have the second quarter gallon application on here. We have a total of 1/2 gallon per square yard into this surface. That was our goal, and it worked quite well. What you watch for prior to rolling is you get rid of, as I would put it, any shine or any wet area. And if you look just beyond me, you can see a little shine or wetness in that wheel path. That is not ready to roll. This near side is, so as soon as I step out of the way, we'll call the roller in. This is ready. Light rolling is fine. particularly on a quarry gravel. Seat the stone, don't over-roll, but this needs some rolling before we go home, especially also because there's some rain in the forecast tonight, and we do want it sealed up prior to rain. Second thing, and I've been asked, can you do blade maintenance on this material? Yes, but when it's working well, it will go into a very tightly bound state. But when you get it in a moist condition from rain, you can do light blading. It's rather forgiving in that regard, but don't do blade maintenance if it's not necessary. Sometimes a motor grader operator simply wants to do some blade maintenance because they're there. If it's not needed, leave it alone. And then the third thing I was asked about, when you get into prolonged dry weather, and we certainly had that last year in the entire Great Plains region, all through the central U.S. and clear into Canada, it got about as dry as it's been since the 1930s. Does it continue to work? Sometimes you'll begin to see some dust. You can rejuvenate it. And the easiest way to accomplish that is put a water truck out very early morning. Same water truck that you saw that we used to prep the road, same process. Just give it a shot of water early morning is best, and you would be surprised at how it reactivates the chloride, and the hygroscopic property comes back, and it begins to pull moisture from the air, plus the water you put on it, and it will retain it, and usually will work the rest of the season when you do it the way we did today. So that really covers it. I will step out of the way. We'll have the roller go by. We've got a good 9-wheel pneumatic roller. That's a good unit to use on this material. You could use a steel drum roller on quarry aggregates with quite a bit of stone exposed. Don't use a steel drum on some of the natural gravels that have a better binding characteristic. In that case, it will usually stick to the steel drum, and a pneumatic, as we have today, is a better roller. And that's a good all-round roller to do compaction after treatment. So again, I'll step aside and we'll finish. I want to point out something here, and this is staged for the benefit of training, but this is an example of rolling too early. And when you do that, you pump the chloride back to the surface, and that counteracts the absorption that we want to get. So again, don't roll until it's ready. If you have any shine or wet area, don't roll. As soon as you lose the shine, we come out of here onto a surface where we know we've gotten absorption, then it's ready to roll. And go ahead and do your rolling. But again, the example of rolling too early, it will pump the product back to the surface, and that's what we do not want for a good stabilization project with liquid magnesium chloride and gravel.
That's the final clip we're going to watch today. I'm going to go back to my slides. In the way of conclusion, and that's simply the title of the slide, I firmly believe the first sentence under there, that treating gravel with liquid mag chloride really isn't complicated. Now, there are a few simple things, and again, that's the next statement. I believe they're relatively simple. But they have to be done correctly. It has to be planned, do it right, and then it works. Perhaps I could put it this way, it's simple enough to define. It can be challenging out in the field sometimes, but I still don't think this is a highly technical process. Then, look at all of the sub-points there just to reiterate what we've talked about. Good quality surface aggregate, good roadway shape. Once more, pre-wet, because you cannot treat a dry road. Prepare that surface very carefully. Do your work ahead of time. Apply the chloride accurately. That's in the vendor's hands. Wait for absorption, and then use your rollers. I do not recommend any rolling prior to treatment. Now, I want to show you very quickly just a handful of slides from projects that I've worked on. You can see the text. This road was constructed actually late May 2011. It was retreated early June 2012. A motor grader, with the exception of snow removal, but a motor grader was never on this road for maintenance purposes in between. I have gotten this kind of performance in projects that I have worked on and advised folks in constructing in more places than this one, but this is one. Here's one more slide of that. This was last October, end of season in 2013. And now you see the traffic count. It's carrying just over 600 vehicles a day, but more importantly, 600 of them are trucks. This carries a lot of heavy traffic. This is in a region, western South Dakota, just east of Rapid City, South Dakota. Very dry area. Also, the inset picture is actually a close-up of that skid mark. But this road has no asphalt in it. It's certainly not paved. It is nothing but a chloride-treated gravel road. Here's another one. This one has much longer term performance. As a matter of fact, in about another month and a half, this road will have performed for 16 years. If you can see that dome structure in the upper right of the slide, that is storage for Portland Cement. And this facility is an offloading station for Portland Cement from rail cars to trucks. There's no way to access this except on a gravel road. Originally, there was some plan to pave it, but there was no money. To try to maintain it as a common untreated gravel road would have been impossible. This one is now, again, in its 16th year as a chloride-treated road. And I didn't take this slide in a particularly good time. It performs like that virtually all season long. And finally, if we have some folks from municipalities, primarily I've talked about rural sections, but we're seeing it used in some municipal situations. This is a mag chloride treated street. You can see what it is. On the right side, primarily residential, but on the left side, it's an athletic complex. I don't know that there's a significant amount of truck traffic here, but there's a very high volume of light traffic, plus an awful lot of start, stop, turning, braking, and so forth. But you can see how this one is performed. This city has done treatment now for over 15 years, and they're very happy with it. Now, a poll as we begin to wrap up here and look towards some questions. I won't be following up on this. Others will. But we are interested, if you would be interested in talking to someone about DustGard, the registered trademark name, in this case for a liquid magnesium chloride, which I've been talking about. Simply, yes or no. Again, would you be interested in talking to someone about DustGard? And go ahead and answer either way. You will get more information on what the product itself is, more than I've been able to convey, along with pricing and so forth. And that may be of interest to a lot of you, or being able to talk to a vendor and so forth. I'm the technical guy talking about the process. Now, Beth, I am ready for questions, but if we need more time for the poll, you step in and give me guidance, please.
All right, great. Well, we'll just give a couple more seconds here for our audience to just answer that last poll, and then we will be jumping into the housekeeping there, and as well as the slides. Maybe before we move on, Ken, did you want to leave the audience with any final thoughts before we move on to our housekeeping and our Q&A?
Yes. I would like to comment on something about pre-rolling, as some people call it, prior to applying the chloride. And I don't like that. I have done it rarely. And I've worked with this for a long, long time. That defeats the purpose of absorption. Post-rolling or rolling after treatment is okay. But I want to add something, and I won't go back to the slide, but that road that was carrying over 600 vehicles per day, with over 100 of those being trucks, gets nothing but one pass, sometimes of shoulder compaction. They run a roller up and down the shoulder, and they do no other compaction. They simply get out of the way, and as the manager in that department says, Ken, there's 600 vehicles a day on it. All we have to do is get absorption, step out of the way, and they'll compact it for us. So it really is quite forgiving. And then a summary statement on this. What I like about this, it reduces maintenance costs dramatically on these high-volume roads, particularly those that probably in better times would be paved. If you can't afford that and you're doing this, when you either reduce blade maintenance to one or a few passes a year, or, as the case the one I showed you, none, this becomes a very cost-effective process. Now, the public likes dust control, and I understand that, and that may be why many are doing it. But I like the stabilization characteristic to save maintenance costs because I work constantly with local agencies all over this country and in some cases outside of the U.S. And at the agency level, that's what drives so much of what we do, and that's the cost. That's my wrap-up, Beth.
All right, great. Well, thank you so much, Ken. And we will be starting our Q&A in just a minute here. We're just going to cover a few housekeeping items for those of you that might have to jump off the line. So a couple of housekeeping items before we start our Q&A. First, your feedback is important to us, so please take a minute to complete the short survey, which will pop up after the webinar is complete. Second, prior to the webinar, we emailed out a link to the PDF of today's presentation. If you didn't receive it, you can download it from the interface. There's a little button there that says Slides, and you can download it there. Also, you can download any of the sign-in sheets that you need. Those are all on the left-hand side of your interface there. If you go under Event Resources, you'll see the group sign-in sheet, as well as any registration sheets for people who have not registered yet. If you missed any part of this webinar or would like to view it again, you may do so via the link which we'll email out tomorrow, and actually it'll be the same link as this webinar right now, so the webcast version will be available and you can watch that. That'll be up for 1 year. This webcast will be available at ForesterUniversity.net for the next 12 months. As a reminder, all attendees can receive 1 PDH and 0.1 CEUs if you stayed the length and are registered for this webcast. If you are listening in a group with attendees who have already registered, please download the group sign-in sheet, which I mentioned, available on the left of the interface. Complete it and send it off to Amber at amcaldowney@forester.net after the webinar. If you're listening in a group with attendees who have not already registered, so those would be people who did not go through the online registration, not a problem. Just download and complete the registration sheet, also available on the left of the interface, and return it to Amber after the webinar. And with that, I'll put up Ken's contact information and information for upcoming webinars, including our design and construction of permeable pavement presented by David Hine next week on June 19th. Our two-session Hydrology 101 for those who skipped it in college webinar presented by former IECA President David Williams on June 24th and 26th. Our Selecting the Best TRM ECB for Your Project webinar presented by best-selling author Jerry Feifeld and Tina Wills on July 24th. Also, we invite you to check out Gravel Roads Academy's on-demand webcast, Get Schooled in Gravelology, available with our other 100 plus webcasts at ForesterUniversity.net. And with that, we're going to go ahead and open up for questions, and we've got a ton of questions in here, and thank you all so much for being participating. Our first question comes in, and the first question is, I must have missed it, but why do you add magnesium chloride to gravel road surface?
Okay, the purpose for using liquid magnesium chloride in everything that I've shown you, not only the video clips but the roads that I showcased, is it is a hygroscopic product which pulls moisture from the atmosphere. Compared to simply watering a road, and in that case you could get it into a good and tight, dense state, but it's not going to stay that way very long, particularly in a semi-arid or an arid region. When you add the liquid magnesium chloride, it constantly draws moisture from the atmosphere. And there's a little more to it. If you have some clay content in the fine material in your aggregate, it has a reaction with that that is positive, and it really keeps it bound. But that's the reason. It becomes we joke about this, but in South Dakota we call it poor man's pavement. Without the chloride and simply using water, the road with 600 vehicles a day would probably, if we get no rain, would have to have blade maintenance every week. It had no maintenance for a year, and that's what the chloride did for us. And I saw a question specific to that. When did they retreat? After 1 year. And I think that covers that one, Beth.
All right, great. Well, thank you for that question. Another question here, I have it: to what depth do you apply the aggregate, and how would you determine a good depth?
That's a challenging question. I'll answer the first part of the question. I do not like to see less than 3 inches. That would be a compacted depth now. I don't like to see less than 3 inches of a good surface aggregate layer so that we can open it, prepare it, do everything we talked about it about rather, and then treat it. You need that much to do a good job. However, if the concern is, do we have enough depth to carry loads, for example, all of those trucks, that gets into design. And there is simply not a one-size-fits-all answer that I can give on that. I will tell you that that road carrying the 600 vehicles per day has just over 10 inches total aggregate thickness on it. The road that is carrying those cement haulers has just over 8. As a matter of fact, we found up to 10 on that road as well, but no less than 8 inches total aggregate depth to carry the loads. We don't need all of that depth to treat with chloride. The 3 inches is very adequate for that. But the second part of the question really is challenging. It depends on the subgrade soil condition, the drainage, and the average annual moisture. I'll confine my answer to that because it really would have to be site-specific design if you're going to carry a lot of trucks and not expect failure for other reasons.
All right, well, good question there. We have our next question is, what is the recommended gallons per mile application rate?
I'll give you one example, but that's not a pat answer again. For example, if we're treating simply 2 inches, which we showed in the video, that material accepted 1/2 gallon per square yard. Now, I'll tell you what that would be on 1 mile. A 24-foot mile is what we were simulating. 1 mile in length, 24-foot width. I've got that in my head after all these years. That is 14,080 square yards of surface. At 1/2 gallon per square yard, that requires then 7,040 gallons of product. And that would be typical of what we've had on some of our roads and gotten season-long performance. But keep in mind, that's for a 24-foot top width, 1 mile, and an application rate of 1/2 gallon per square yard. You have to get used to this. There's a lot of field judgment involved. That's going to vary depending on road width and how much material you need to get good absorption and good performance.
All right, great. Next question, Ken, is how much do you wet the road? What is the optimum moisture content?
I'll give you the best guidance I can, particularly those of you that are used to field operations and are used to compacting base gravel, for example. If you are skilled at reaching just about the optimum amount of moisture for good compaction, that is exactly what I like to see for chloride treatment, except don't do any compaction ahead of time. But when you've got that moisture right at the content at which you would want to get max density, if you're trying to meet that specification for a base, that's exactly what has worked best for me for chloride treatment. You do need that much water. And if I could use the slang, you want the, in appearance, you want the very high end of damp, close to wet, but not shiny wet. Now you've got too much water in it. You'll have to wait just a little bit. If you've got a sunny, windy day, I'm a little more concerned about too dry than too wet. If it's chilly, cloudy, damp, then you do have to be a little careful and don't overwater. But again, you get very close to what would be optimum for compaction, and you've got it ready for chloride treatment.
All right, good. Well, thank you for that question. Next question here comes in, and the question is, how often does reapplication need to be done?
Okay, I'll draw upon my experience because there is not one pat answer for that. When you apply at the higher rates that I was showing, I have gotten season-long performance with a single treatment in many, many cases. I have also seen, it would be hard to define all of these situations, but I have seen treatments twice annually where they will do a late spring application, and in some cases it's because of their gravels. They don't have the perfect gradation that we'd like to see, if they don't have that percentage of fines that we want. In that case, they may have to treat again, and that's generally done late summer. I have not seen projects that performed well that ever required more than two treatments in a season. That's all I have on that one, Beth.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much. Next question here comes in, and the question is, a 4% crown seems very steep. What would you say about regional or state standards that are less than 4%?
Okay, I'll draw on my experience, and first of all, background to the 4%. 4% is coming from three sources. First of all, the Federal Highway Gravel Roads Manual, which recommends 4%. AASHTO, highest authority in the land for design standards or guidance, has a very broad range of 2-6%. That doesn't give us very definitive guidance, but 4 would be right in the middle. And third source is an old pocket guide for motor grader operators that was produced by the National Association of County Engineers. And that one recommends the 1/2 inch per foot drop on the cross slope, which again corresponds almost exactly to 4%, up to 3/4 inch, which goes to 6%. Now, let me give a little more definitive guidance from my experience. 2% is mentioned over and over and over again in the road maintenance and construction industry, but that's specific to pavements, both concrete and asphalt. That is not enough crown to get water off of an unpaved road, in other words, a gravel surface. If you're in a semi-arid or arid region, you may get by with 3%. But folks, you're going to have to trust me, and I often say, pardon my strong views, but I've been on a lot of roads in a lot of places, and 4% is good guidance. However, don't ever exceed 6. We could have a few folks on the other side of the fence where they believe you can't get enough crown. Be careful with that, too. I'm going beyond the question that was asked, but don't ever exceed 6. But stay at or near 4. 90%+ of the time in all of the field situations that I've worked on, those have performed well.
All right, good. Well, thank you for that question. Our next question comes in, and the next question is, your example used a limestone crush stone. Is MGCL appropriate for granites or sandstones?
Yes, a granite material, which I've worked with, can be fine. Quarry gravels, by and large, are good. Number one, they're 100% fractured, and that helps with aggregate interlock. But I want to emphasize again, no matter what the material, you need that percentage of fines. You need a good overall gradation, again. But you need that percentage of true fines, which would be that material passing a number 200 sieve, so that that material will naturally go into a dense and hopefully a bound state. Then these chloride treatments take over and perform very well. Sandstones, yes, a caution, some of these materials are pretty soft, and that includes some of the limestones. Be a little careful with those because they'll break down under traffic. Generally, we don't do a lot of testing for soundness in our plain old surface gravels or aggregates, but be careful with a very soft aggregate. It will break down under traffic, and you can have some trouble with these treatments where it will become slick. That's probably the best way I could put it, as the aggregate breaks down, and now you've got too much fine material at or near the surface. But I've used a lot of different materials all over this country, and again, even outside the U.S., and I find this pretty forgiving. As long as you stay within those bands on the gradation, and especially if you can get the plasticity in the fine material, then, you trust me, you can get the performance I demonstrated. I didn't pick just a few very good jobs here. We've gotten this in many, many places.
Excellent. All right. Well, we've got time for a few more questions here, so you can keep sending those in. And, of course, if we don't get to yours, we definitely will be following up with those on email. All right. Well, our next question here comes in from Vincent, and he asks, does the application rate vary with the amount or type of traffic, for example, truck versus car?
A little bit. It is much more sensitive to the type of material that you have. However, a higher volume of traffic doesn't hurt us. I really don't care if we have the 600 vehicles. By the way, I've worked with two sections in the past, over 1,000 vehicles per day. They don't hurt us. I'm talking total volume. Now let me address the matter of trucks. Yes, that has some bearing. I once worked on a project where we had a treated gravel road going to a lumber mill with a very high volume of log trucks. And to be bluntly honest, many of them were overloaded and we couldn't control it. We did have some problem there where the constant heavy loading and deflection of the surface pumped the fine material to the surface of the road. And we learned to use a little less chloride on that road. And the following season, when it was prepared for retreatment, and again, it was working quite well. They were treating only once annually, but they had to very aggressively open that road. And again, they had bit-type cutting edges on a motor grader, and they would loosen a full 3 inches to get the stone back up on the top. So yes, you have to be a little careful with a high volume of truck traffic. In that case, I've often recommended no more than about generally 10 hundredths. If we were shooting for a half gallon, we would drop to about 4/10. Again, it's site specific, but that's the best guidance I can give you.
All right, good. Let's see. Our next question here comes in, and the question is there an area that mag-chlor, so that's mag-clor, will not work due to a lack of humidity and rainfall?
My quick answer is no, because I had some contact with people out of mines, I believe in Chile or Peru, I've forgotten which country, but they had a whole new definition of arid where it virtually didn't rain at all, and they were still using chlorides. They were using higher application rates than I've talked about today, but they were also using water trucks. When it would begin to dust a little, they would simply go out and apply water. Again, generally very early morning when the sun and very low humidity did not immediately dry the water off. And they were still very happy, and to my knowledge, are still using it to this day.
All right, good. Well, good question. Next question here is, how do fluoride surface treatments work on roadways that are plowed in the winter months?
There's no significant difference compared to an untreated gravel road. Some of my friends actually like the chloride-treated gravel better because they remained, once again, what we like in the summer, they remain bound. It does the same in winter, and some of them can use truck plows on those, whereas on an untreated gravel road with too much loose aggregate, the truck plow doesn't work. It will cast off too much aggregate. However, in general, they're really no different than an untreated gravel road. Just treat them the same for snow removal.
All right, good. And I think we're going to end today on this last question. I know there's a lot of questions in there, and thank you so much for sending those in. And like I said, we'll be following up on those. But our last question here, Ken, comes in and asks, on the 16-year cement access road, what was all that was done to make it last that amount of time? Were there other treatments with the MGCL too?
Okay, brief as I can make it, here's a history to that project. The road was completely reshaped, and an 8-inch lift of virgin gravel was brought in. It was treated the very first year with liquid magnesium chloride. Thereafter, that road receives a once annual treatment. It is generally treated very late May or early June, right about this time of the year. They also very aggressively reshape each spring just prior to the treatment. And when I say reshape, they're not clear down in the ditches, but what I mean, they do an aggressive reshape of the surface. I have not checked with them in the last year, but a year prior I did. They have added only 200 tons of gravel to that entire section, which is 2 miles, by the way. But they have only added 200 tons of gravel in that entire period of time because the chloride holds it, and you don't lose your aggregate off to the inslope or the ditches. That's the entirety that's been done there. It does, again, though I'll emphasize, gets a full annual retreatment of chloride, of liquid magnesium chloride.
All right, great. Well, thank you all so much for all of these wonderful questions and for interacting with us both during our Q&A today and, of course, our polls and, of course, following the webinar, the survey that will pop up for you. Before I move on, we already talked a couple last-minute things, but I thought I might just throw it over to you and see if you had any final comments, maybe following up these Q&As before I move on to our last housekeeping items.
Just a couple of things. First of all, I've never done a webinar with nearly 150 questions. I really, really appreciate this. I'm very sorry. We just don't have any more time. I would if I could, but these are expensive. And my final comment is we need to thank our sponsor, the people that step up to do this, North American Salt, a subsidiary of Compass Minerals. I really appreciate it. Due to them, we're able to do this. I hope we help people. That's my big goal, just to help everybody do a better job of maintaining and managing local roads. That's my final comment, and then a personal thank you from me.
All right, great. Well, a personal thank you from us, too, to you, Ken, and to everyone, of course, who joined us today. And then, as Ken said, of course, to our sponsor. Today's webinar is brought to you free thanks to our sponsor, Gravel Roads Academy. Gravel Roads Academy, sponsored by the North American Salt Company, offers information and training on how to better maintain your gravel roads for superior stabilization, greater cost savings, and better air quality. The course curriculum includes road design, road maintenance, road stabilization, program efficiency, and field training. To learn more, you can visit them at gravelroadsacademy.com, which is on the screen as well. We hope you can join us for our upcoming webinars, including our design and construction of permeable pavement, presented next week by returning presenter David Hine on June 19th, covering the ins and outs of permeable pavement design and construction through real-world work examples. Our popular two-session Hydrology 101 for those who skipped it in college webinar presented by former IECA President David Williams on June 24th and 26th, exploring the concepts, terms, and analysis behind hydrology and hydrological studies, and our Selecting the Best TRM ECV for Your Project webinar presented by bestselling author Jerry Feitfeld and Tina Wills on July 24th, exploring the current erosion control blankets and turf reinforcement mats on the market, and how you can assess and select the best product for your project. And if you would like to share this webinar with others, please do so. This webcast will be available at ForesterUniversity.net for the next 12 months as an on-demand recording. Well, until next time, thank you again, everybody who joined us today, our sponsor and Ken, and have a great rest of your day.
Thank you, everyone.